last couple of weeks, did you?
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Welcome to St. Faustina Parish. The Little Sisters of the Poor will be at the entrance of the church after Mass to collect for the support of their ministry of caring for the elderly poor in Pittsburgh. Please be as generous as possible. The Harvest Celebration is next weekend. Get your tickets for the $10,000 raffle now before they're gone. If you have been selling tickets, please get those to the parish office or to George Pry as soon as possible. There's a second collection next weekend for World Missions. Thank you for your generosity. Donations are appreciated for a new stove for our parish. Envelopes are available or mark your check accordingly. Thank you for your help. Please note the weekday Mass changes as Father Sean is out of town this week. The Ladies Guild will meet on Thursday at St. Christopher at 1 o'clock to discuss their fall activities. Tuesday the 24th at 7 p.m., there will be a safety speaker at St. Peter Church Hall. This is for anyone interested in helping our youth make wise decisions. As a reminder, next Sunday, all confirmation students will meet at 5:30 p.m. at the Newman Center instead of their morning class. There will be a special candle lighting ceremony at the Mass of Commemoration of our faithful departed on November 14th at St. Peter at 7 p.m. Please RSVP by calling the office. Attendance is necessary. Father John will be our celebrant this afternoon. Please welcome him.
Retired priest who lives out in Boone Township. 59 miles
from my two-room apartment to your place here. It's a good journey today. I don't know if you remember or not, but about 2 months ago, we were together. It was a Feast of the Transfiguration. It was the White Vestments. Remember, we talked about the fact that it was payday. They were up on the mountain and recalled the fact that we now have an energy in God's presence. Well, it's good to be with you again as we gather. It's the Green Vestments of Ordinary Time. It's week number 28. There are 34 such weeks. We've got six more to go until the end of next month. We'll celebrate the great solemnity of Christ the King, and then the Sunday after that, the first Sunday in December, we start it all over again in the great cycle. So as we gather on this 28th Sunday of Ordinary Time, we always begin by asking the Lord to forgive us for our sinfulness. You were sent from the right hand of the Father to take away all sin. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
From the right hand of the Father, you reconcile hearts one to the other. Proclaim a gospel by which we love each other in your name, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us all our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In verdant pastures, he gives me repose. Beside restful waters, he leads me. He refreshes my soul. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. He guides me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil. For you are at my side, with your rod and your staff, that give me courage. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. You spread the table before me, in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
Abundance. In every circumstance and in all things, I have learned the secret of being well fed and of going hungry, of living in abundance and of being in need. I can do all things in Him who strengthens me. Still, it was kind of you to share in my distress. My God will fully supply whatever you need in accord with his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father, glory forever and ever. Amen.
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 May the Father of
began to speak once more and said to the people, "The kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who gave a wedding feast to his son. He dispatched the first group of servants to summon the invited guests to the feast, but they refused to come. A second time he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those invited, behold, I have prepared my banquet. My calves and cattle are killed, and everything is ready. Come to the feast.' Some ignored the invitation and went away, one to his farm, another to the business. The rest laid hold of his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged and sent his troops, destroyed these murderers, burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The feast is ready. Those who were invited were not worthy to come. Go out therefore into the main roads and invite to the feast whomever you find.' So the servants went out into the streets and byways and gathered all they found, bad and good alike, and the hall was filled with guests." This is the proclamation of the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Last time you and I were together was the Feast of the Transfiguration. You probably don't remember, I do, because I'm honored when I come up here to be with you. And it was the white vestments of ordinary. And now you notice we're back to green vestments. The green vestments of ordinary times. Now, ordinary doesn't mean plain or simple or common. Ordinary time comes from the Latin word ordinaria. Remember when you were in elementary school and learned about numbers? Numbers were in two different categories. There were and cardinal numbers. Cardinal was what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Ordinal or what? First, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. Because it comes from the Latin word ordinaria, which means one after another. And so this is week number 29. Last week was 28, next week is 30. There are 34 weeks of ordinary time. We just tick them off one after the other, basically. And of course, in this year, it's the year of Matthew's gospel. Last year when you came during ordinary time, it was Luke's gospel. Next year it'll be Mark's gospel. It's that three-year cycle of our Roman liturgy. By the way, John's gospel we have every year during Lent and Easter, you recall. And so the idea is, if you come every Sunday for 3 years to the liturgy, you literally have heard all the Gospels. And so the idea is, each Gospel gives us a different version of Jesus. That's the understanding that our Roman Catholic liturgy suggests. That the whole Bible is open to us, basically. And we see that in a three-year cycle. By the way, that's why other Christian ministers, preachers, are much better preachers than Catholic priests or deacons. And the simple reason is because every Sunday they can pick the readings they want. If you belong to a Pentecostal church in Slippery Rock and a Pentecostal church in Pittsburgh, on this Sunday they have two different readings. If you belong to an evangelical church in Butler, the evangelical church in Philadelphia, they would have two different readings. The individual minister, he or she can pick whatever readings they want. And so they're always going to be picking familiar readings. For instance, if I say to anyone in this assembly, "Tell me something about the Steelers," I imagine everybody could say something about it. They could tell about the Super Bowls, they could about numbers, they could tell everything. If I said, "Tell me something about the Commanders." Who? Commanders is the NFL team in Washington. You're very familiar with the team in which you can speak. That's the difference. The other ministers can pick any readings they want from the scriptures. Roman Catholic priests and deacons, we don't have that choice. Every Roman Catholic church in the world has the readings you heard today. Because the idea of the church is, we're not letting the picking of the gospel readings up to the priest. No. We want all of the gospel to be exposed to us. And so often many of the other Christian people point to you and me and say, "You Roman Catholics don't know the Bible." We certainly know the Bible. We proclaim the scriptures. We sing them. We celebrate them. And so this is the year in which we have Matthew's gospel. Now, Matthew is a gospel written for Jewish people. So Matthew wants to invite the Jewish people to come now follow Jesus. So what does he do? Remember the first 5 books of the Bible were attributed to Moses? Remember you used to call them the Pentateuch? Penta means 5. Tuke means scroll. And so remember, there's no books in those days. They were all scrolls. And so when the Jewish minister was going to the temple, he was carrying 5 scrolls. And open up the scroll and tell about Moses. So what does Matthew do? He writes his gospel and he lets Jesus give 5 speeches. So all during this year, for 29 weeks, we've been following Matthew's gospel. Have you been following the speeches of Jesus? Everybody here knows the first speech Jesus gave. We call it the Sermon on the Mount. Everyone knows that one. That's in chapter 1. But as we've moved through this year, we came into chapter 10, where Jesus gathered the 12 and sent them out and gave them a speech when he sent them out. They were missionaries. And then he went to chapter 13. We had all the parables of the kingdom. That was the third speech. Now, 3 weeks ago, we started the 4th speech, which is about how we live together. So remember a couple of weeks ago, it was Peter asking, how often should we forgive someone? And then last week, the story about the son that didn't want to go to work for the daddy. These 4 speeches about how we live in this church of Jesus and how we get involved in the church of Jesus. By the way, the 5th speech will start next week when Jesus will talk about the final times. They're the 5 speeches of Matthew's gospel that give us an understanding that we don't simply follow the Torah, the Pentateuch. No, we go beyond that. How many people you know say, hey, Father, I don't go to church very often. I don't get involved in helping up at the raffle or helping at the harvest. I don't help in any way, but I keep the commandments. You know what happens when you keep the commandments? Makes you a good Jew. We do more than that. We go beyond the commandments. The commandments are not good enough. We've got to come to the gospel of Jesus. So we keep the commandments and go way beyond that. And that's what Matthew's gospel does. Gives us the gospel to say, and you've heard this in the gospel. You heard it said of old, you can't commit adultery. I say this to you. You heard about it so old, you can't cheat. I say this to you. You've heard that. Sure, you keep the 10 commandments, but we go beyond it. And so Matthew creates that for us for sure. And so now we're gathered during this year of Matthew's gospel, following along, we understand how Jesus gives us a new way to live. Now, notice what happens. Every Sunday when you come to celebrate, the first reading, as Barb read to us so effectively, is from the Hebrew Scripture, from the Old Testament. This week it's Isaiah. And you notice what the church does? This is brilliance in Catholic liturgy. The church goes through the Hebrew Scriptures, we call the Old Testament, pulls out a reading every Sunday to get you ready for the gospel. So the reading today was about the feast that God gave to the people at the time of Isaiah. What's the gospel about? The feast that Jesus speaks about in terms of the final kingdom. It happens every week. Last week it was the same thing. Remember? It was about the forgiveness of God. Because the gospel is about the mercy of God. And so every Sunday, that first reading sets us up for the gospel. That's the uniqueness of our Catholic faith. We don't just pick readings. No. It's built one upon the other. And so today, Isaiah talks about the fact that God is going to create this great feast. See, in those days, when you say to somebody, what do you think heaven's like? For them, it was a great feast. Now remember, they lived in a desert where water was scarce, wine even more scarce. There wasn't any luscious food they could eat. And so you would say to someone, what do you think heaven's going to be like? Oh, it'll be a great feast. With all the water you could drink, and the wine will be delicious, and the food will be rich. That's what Barb read to us today. That's their image of God's eternal kingdom. And so the idea is we stay faithful, and ultimately, we get to that kingdom of God. Now, we know it's not a feast with that kind of food, but it's a symbol. A symbol of what's the best thing you can have in this world? Heaven's even better. And so Isaiah speaks in terms of that feast. Now, what happens? The church pulls out that reading from Isaiah, to get you and me ready for the gospel. Where does the gospel become the story of a feast? Every week it's like that. You got to get that. That's Roman Catholic liturgy. Oh, that first reading gets me ready for the gospel? Yeah, we know that. Well, the gospel is about the feast. And notice, this gospel is more than just a parable. It's like an allegory. See, a parable is a little short story from life that gives you one point of reference. An allegory takes each element in the story and gives a symbolic meaning to it. And so this parable is a king has a great feast. God's represented by the king, and God's having this great feast. Now God sends out people to come to the feast. And of course, many, many people don't. How many people you know don't come to the liturgy any longer? Don't get involved in church any longer? The invitation of God reaches out to them. But they're like that first group of servants. They don't want to come to the great feast of God, so they don't come. Doesn't make them bad people. They just don't come. So then the king says, well, send out a second group. And the second group come up, and the first group is so ticked off, they start to beat up the servants. How many times have you been with other people that don't come to liturgy, and they put you down? They talk about all the evils in the church. They talk about the horror of religion. It's a symbol in the story. And so the second group of servants, they can't get anything better. So what happens? The king says, well, since you're not going to do it, we're going to go ask others to come to the feast for my son. That's what this is. The feast for the Son of God. You responded. You're here. You fit yourself right into the image of this gospel. You've come now to the feast to be nourished by the Lord. And ultimately, what happens? They begin to just get people and come. The call of the church is for everyone to come. Not simply to come to the feast, but we got involved in this. And of course, in the United States of America, the bishops have come together and say, the way you get involved in your faith, they talk about the three T's, time, talent, and treasure. You've heard that many times. Time is what? I give some of my time to the church. I give some of my time to the gospel. So that maybe you're somebody that could help at the harvest. You're somebody that could support the sisters when they're at the doors of the church. You're somebody that could work with the young people. You're somebody, whatever. How many people you know, when they're invited to do this, hey, well, I don't have any time. I got too many other things to do. I don't have any time to give to the church. That's getting involved. Then they talk about talent. Talent is something you're able to do. Maybe I can't do much with time, but I could help. I'm a teacher. I could help with the faith formation program. I know something about music. I could join the choir or begin to be part of the music ministry. I could get involved in the finances of the parish and work on the financial council or the pastoral council. I can get involved in all the programs we have in some way and get involved, lending a hand in here. See, I use my talent to get involved. That's the gospel. And of course, the final one is people have difficulty with. That's the treasure. That's actually the money I have. We have a collection every Sunday. Some can't give to that. We're selling tickets to the $10,000 raffle. Some can't give that $100. That's understandable. But I can give my time and my talent. And some can give time, talent, and also treasure. That's the invitation of the gospel. That's why this particular story is a parable turned into an allegory. Many, many people were invited to the church. And you know them, don't you? I know them. They don't come. They have complaints and criticisms, all kinds of difficulties with the church. That's those persons in the first part of that allegory. But then they just send out the invitation. And all of a sudden, the church is filled on a 4 o'clock liturgy. Because you hear the call of God and come. And of course, the importance is that we come now to be nourished by Jesus, strengthened by Him. See, that's why Catholic liturgy has two parts to it. Most other denominational Christians simply have a reading of the Bible. Now, we're not better than they are, of course not. We are certainly different. Not only do we have the reading of the Bible, for sure, that's the whole first part of our liturgy, but then the Bible gives us challenges, doesn't it? Every Sunday when you come, you hear the gospel of Jesus challenging us. And you and I know that none of us are strong enough to live that challenge. So what happens? We have the opportunity to come to the Eucharist. That's the other half of our understanding of Catholic liturgy. And now that Eucharist gives us the strength to live the challenges of the gospel. That's the two parts of Catholic liturgy that distinguishes us from other Christians. Not better than they are, certainly different than they are. And ultimately then, word and sacrament gives us the strength to go to the world and to make it a better place. We are struggling in this world, aren't we? We see racism that's running rampant everywhere. Ethnic profiling against people. Gender bias against women. We have people that are afraid to go out at night because of shootings in malls, in churches, in neighborhoods. That's the world we live in. We just can't close our eyes to that. We've got to have the strength of the gospel to change that world for the God of heaven. And that's what we do when we come. So many people. You know, I like to go to Mass at 4 o'clock because it makes me feel good. You want to feel good, take an aspirin. That's not what liturgy's about. Liturgy's about giving you the strength of Christ to go back out into the world and to change this world for God. See, that's the strength that we have when we hear the gospel proclaimed and the Eucharist. Now, we feel a lot better about ourselves when we come, of course. But we don't just stop there at that. We have to take the goodness of that understanding and go out into this world. And that's the parable of today. It's a great feast of heaven. Isaiah tells us about it. That's the symbolism. And now this king gives a feast for his son. God is our king, his son is the Lord Jesus. And now he invites all of us to come to that. And you've come faithfully, which is magnificently wonderful. And as you come to that, we meet the challenge of the gospel. And by the way, that's really the promise of Jesus. If you stay faithful to his gospel in this world, then don't worry about dying at all. Because if you happen to die, you'll enter into the great kingdom of the king, and you'll be at that great banquet of heaven. And the peace, and the joy, and the love of the Lord Jesus will be yours. I believe in one God.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who the Lord's abundant love and care bring them peace and healing. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For this community of faith, may the light of God's love guide our every word and action. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died in the light of Christ, may they be welcomed to eternal rest and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The intention of this Mass is for Francis Butch Thompson. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
As we gather in your name, celebrating the wonder of your love, and looking forward to the glory of your kingdom, where with Christ we will live forever and ever.
Amen.
We bring our gifts, our prayers, and our concerns to the altar today. Please join together in singing number 663, You Alone. 663.
Glory of heaven, and suffer the Lord Jesus at a meal at the last
forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and ever, we give you thanks, Lord, holy God, and almighty and eternal God. For through the mystery of his dying and rising, the Lord Jesus accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works, who have called us out of darkness in your own wonderful light. And so, with all the angels and saints, we proclaim your glory as we sing.
Father, in the unity
gallons free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant our peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peaceful presence of the Christ be with you always.
And with your spirit.
If I can turn on to the other with some upward sign to share the peace of the Lord Jesus. Thank you. We entreat your majesty, most humbly, Father, that it would be us now at this banquet of the Eucharist, that we receive the body and blood of your Son in this world, that we may become sharers of his divine nature and live with him in the glorious kingdom that will last forever and ever.
Amen.
I'm always honored with having blessed me to be with you. This is very often, but your attention, your participation is wonderful. That's a good sense, you know. I've been a priest in this diocese for 55 years, and I've been all over the place, I'm sure. I know what's happening in many places. And you really have a great spirituality to bond together. I hope you continue that way. If you take your spirituality and make it spread it across all six counties of this diocese, we're going to be better off than that, no question. It's good to be with you. Now, today we're around the liturgy. Maybe not to give time for talents, but to give treasure. Because Sister Joseph is at the door of the church, and she's collecting for the little sisters of four. I grew up in Mount Washington. I know the city of Pittsburgh, like back of my hand. And the little sisters of four were pretty magnificent. No one gets ever turned away. You know, when I talk about the fact that you're going to give something, treasure, and that will go exactly to the people that need it, no administration, no other cost, that's what happens with the sisters of four. Their commitment is to that. So, they have a couple of shekels as you leave today, maybe you can kind of drop it into the sister in a little collection there. You know for sure it's going to help people that are poor, invest in food, and not live without anything in their life. The Lord be with you.
And
may the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon all of us and remain with us forever and ever.
Amen.
The celebration of our liturgy is ended. Let us always live with the peace of the Lord Jesus.
Our closing hymn today is number 213, Holy, Holy, Holy. I see that 3 is trying to get away, but it's number 213.